Good afternoon, I'm Bob Zimmer. I'm sure that I shared an experience with all of you last May when we heard about Gary Becker's death. And that was not only a profound sadness and the shock of this actually having happened, but the instant sense of just how much we had lost. Of course, each of us had our own distinctive relationship with Gary, and so a feeling of just how much we had lost surely varied from person to person. But what was remarkable about Gary is how the depth of this loss could be felt in so many ways. Another way of saying this is just how rich was what Gary gave to the world and to each of us. For some here this afternoon, this event is first about Gary as a husband and family member, both roles to which he was devoted. For others, this is about the extraordinary role as a professional colleague and the friendships that developed around that. For others, it reflects the revolution in thought that he brought about and the impact that he had on the world. My relationship with Gary inevitably led me to feel the loss immediately in two ways: as a friend whom I greatly admired and trusted deeply, and because of what Gary represented about Chicago economics and what the University of Chicago aspires to be, which in Gary's case was an aspiration fully realized. Let me focus first on the second comment about the University of Chicago. This morning, during Jim Heckman's talk summarizing Gary Becker's work, he quoted Milton Friedman, who in talking about Gary said, "Gary Becker is the greatest social scientist who has lived and worked in the last half century." This is an extraordinary statement, and of course, as president, I would hope to see the university filled with faculty about whom such a statement, even a tenth as strong, could be made. But the feature that I so greatly admired about Gary is what was necessary for him to do this. And this was a degree of intellectual integrity and total intellectual fearlessness that gave his extraordinary abilities and insight the freedom and the room to do something that others would not imagine, nor have the emotional fortitude to carry out. And while this perhaps got easier for Gary over the years, as his ideas moved from being seen to being at the periphery to being so highly honored and revered and essential to the arsenal of every economist, sociologist, and wide range of other social scientists and policymakers, the integrity and fearlessness remained evident in every conversation one would have with him. Never content with his ideas being accepted, there was always another issue, and he would approach it with the same fearlessness and willingness to be outside the standard view that he had shown throughout his whole career. This fearlessness is, in reality, less common, even in a great university, than one might hope, but is necessary for the University of Chicago or any university in order to realize our highest aspirations. And in this way, Gary was a true model for all of us. In the first meeting of the University Board of Trustees after the attack on September 11, 2001, and I was there as vice president for research at the time, Gary spoke to a concerned board about what the implications were for the US economy. As one would expect, Gary argued, from data, from history, and from the perspective of human capital, that in fact, if this were an isolated or mostly isolated event, that one could expect only a transitory impact on the economy. Gary's argument was so calm and careful that it was evident that the board was starting to feel quite a bit relieved, even comforted to be hearing this from Gary. But then, almost casually, he remarked that, of course, there could be other extreme events that were unknown, which could make the situation less predictable. So some left the meeting feeling not quite as comfortable as they might have, but some in attendance, as did I, felt reassured even more because we had heard from someone with an approach of total intellectual honesty. When I returned to Chicago as president in 2006, one of the first stops I made was in Gary's office, because I deeply trusted his views and wanted to understand what would help the economics department, which of course was one of the great jewels of the University of Chicago. There were a number of matters we discussed, but we left that meeting with one major conclusion. We needed an institute for economics and related areas. This took a while to accomplish as the economics department lived up to its reputation as being a place where nothing is simple. But we finally have the Gary Becker Milton Friedman Institute for Research in Economics, which will be a lasting institutional tribute to Gary and his teacher. I'm very glad that we will have this reminder every day of Gary Becker as a keystone of Chicago economics and what it stands for. But the deep sadness of Gary not being here with us to celebrate it and to argue within it will always stay with me. As the days have gone by since May, and even as the years will go by, I know I will continue to miss Gary Becker, my friend and my colleague, very much.
It's been almost 6 months to the day since my father died. I have felt his loss and mourned for him every single day since then, yet I still can't believe he's gone. Other people will speak or have spoken about what a great and accomplished man Gary Becker was, but I will speak about him as my father. Many great men are not great family men, but my father was the best dad anyone could wish for. He was my guide through life and my best friend. He was the rock in my sister Kathy's in my childhood, making us breakfast before we went to school and then putting in a day of intensely productive intellectual work. He would sit with us until we fell asleep and tell us bedtime stories he made up about Squarity Short, a square snake, and the lopsided donkey. They sound like cute children's stories, but they were also lessons about being different and nonconformist. My dad loved to watch The Honeymooners and imitate Ralph Cramden, and he read me the Peanuts comic strip every night. He taught us to ride bikes and drive cars and went sledding, ice skating, and bowling with us. Later, he listened to our young adult problems and always gave sage and positive advice. Although there were many interesting and sometimes argumentative discussions at the dinner table, there was a real regular guy aspect to Gary Becker. When not working, his favorite interests were sports, both watching and playing them, and reading mystery novels. He was as unpretentious as anyone could be, and observing that characteristic in him made a huge impression on me. My father taught me the most valuable lessons in life, how to think for myself, stand up for what I believe in, and never be afraid to go against the tide of public opinion. My father managed to be a maverick and still remain immensely well-liked. I'm not always as likable, few driven people are, but I am proud to follow in his maverick footsteps. He taught my sister to be self-confident when she doubted herself, welcomed her visits to his office when she was an undergraduate here in need of advice, and always encouraged her to try new endeavors. He believed it was never too late to try new things and experience new joys in life. He also taught us how important it is to find work one loves, and I am lucky to be able to work 16-hour days and yet say, like him, that I've never worked a day in my life. The day my father died was the worst day of my life. I still expect to be able to pick up the phone and discuss anything from a good TV series to important life issues with him, and my sister feels the same way about her visits to his office. I know that his wife, my stepmother Gidi, thinks about him ceaselessly. The past 6 months have been, for me, a time of much grieving, introspection, and learning how to live what suddenly feels like a rudderless life. As part of that process, I finally opened and read a box of letters my mother, Doria Sloat, had kept. In the box were many letters written during their courtship in 1952 and 1953, while my father was a graduate student here and his future wife was still on the East Coast. I was charmed to read of my father's excitement at meeting prestigious scholars, not knowing that one day he would be one himself. The letters showed a young man, not yet sure of himself, full of ideas, interested not only in economics, but in evolution and sociology, and worried about passing his French exam. They also spoke of his admiration for his mentor, Milton Friedman. On this occasion, I thought it fitting to quote from one of the letters, written during the period in which he was trying to determine his thesis topic. Quote, "At 4 o'clock, I had a talk with Friedman. This lasted until 5:30. We spoke about lots of things, and I learned a great deal in this period. Primarily, we spoke about the theoretical essay I had written on discrimination. Much to my surprise and delight, Friedman seemed to like it a great deal, more than anything else I had ever shown him. So I shall, at least for a while, continue along these lines," end of quote. And as we know, he did. But in addition to his groundbreaking contributions to the field of economics and sociology, Gary S. Becker really, really loved his family. And for me, that's the most important thing. Thank you.
Seeing all the people here today just reminds me of how wonderful Gary was and how much he meant to all of us. I can tell you in the days following his death, the vast number of emails and calls and notes and that I received, all with a common theme, which was how thankful they were that Gary had taken the time to talk to them and focused on them as individuals and their work. And people felt like he cared especially about them. And that's from hundreds of people. So it's amazing that somebody could have that kind of an effect where everybody viewed him as so focused on what they were interested in. But that was the kind of guy he was. He always took the time to listen to what people had to say, had insightful comments, was interested in what you were working on, and just was focused on you as a person. I guess I would say, when I think about his work, it's something similar that comes to my mind. Gary, you know, when you tell people you're an economist, they always ask you, what's gonna happen to the stock market? You know, when's this recession gonna end? Or something along those lines, or what tax policy ought to be. And Gary recognized that economics wasn't about necessarily measuring GDP and all that stuff. He recognized that economics was about people. And people were at the center of Gary's universe. Just look at the topics he worked on: human capital, the family, discrimination, fertility, marriage and divorce, crime and addiction. People were important to Gary, and if it was important to people, he thought it should be important to economists. Gary put people at the center of his universe, and his choice of topics flowed from that. And I think he really changed our profession in that regard. It's often tempting to think that Gary ventured out from economics and branched economics out in different directions. I actually think he just kept plugging away at economics, and the rest of us didn't realize it was economics until we looked back and saw what he had done. I think he was right on track. He knew people were there, and he knew what mattered to people, and he focused on marriage. Why? Because marriage was important. He focused on the family because family was important. And he focused on all those other things because they were what mattered to people. He kept applying economics to the problems that mattered. And they mattered because they mattered to people, not because they mattered to economists. And I think that's a central feature. And people in Gary's world were complicated people, but they were the same everywhere. People were people, whether they lived 500 years ago, whether they live in the United States, whether they live in China, whether they live in Africa, if they're poor or rich, they all care about the same things. And they don't care about the things that people often stereotypically associate with economists, just income and those things. They care about being loved. They care about loving others. They care about having companionship. They care about their children and their parents. And Gary recognized that. And that's what economics is about. Economics is about people. And I think he just, like I said, stayed at the core of economics because economics is about people. And we kind of came around to that as a profession. And we owe him a great deal, a great debt of gratitude for doing that. And his approach was always that of an economist. In his world, people didn't live alone. They lived in families, but they interacted in a market. And there were lots of markets in Gary's world. There was the market for goods, market for ideas, marriage markets, political markets, markets for illegal goods, markets for criminal activity, and markets could not be banished. Even if you had a system that had no formal markets, markets would show up because they were the way in which people interacted with one another. And that was important. And his approach to people and his approach to his colleagues reflected his same care for people. People were the students, his colleagues, his family. And it's great to hear from his family, and you'll hear more today, I'm sure, about how he was not just a great student of the family, he was a great participant in the family. And I think that's wonderful, and it's a wonderful part of what made him great. I personally, just from my own point of view, learned an enormous amount from Gary. He really helped focus me on, again, that economics is a powerful tool for understanding the world, but understanding the world from the point of view of people and what matters to people. And often that means realizing that people care a lot more than how much income they get, family, friends, being loved, loving others is what really counts. And I can't say enough that Gary did a lot to push the profession in that direction, and in the process enriched our profession as much or more than anybody else I can think of, both because he continued to use the tools that economics had and sort of, like I said, continued to work at the core of economics, but made us realize what the goal line was. And the goal line was to understand human behavior. And behavior was something to be understood, arose because those people who were the same everywhere faced different constraints and they faced different challenges, but they always wanted the same things. And their striving to obtain those things is what defines economics and what defines the research and life of Gary Becker. And I'd like to thank him very much for guiding us down that road. Thank you, Gary.
Good morning, everyone. Gary Becker was my grandfather. I'm really glad you all could be here today. As you already heard, he was a very special man to both his colleagues and to his family. I understand that at services like these, one should really highlight only the best strengths of an individual and focus on the best times they had together. For me, this isn't very difficult, as in my eyes, Gary Becker was nothing but the perfect grandfather. For those who don't know, in our 21 years together, I don't think I ever called him by his first name, last name, or as some of you may refer to him, Professor. For 21 years, I only called him Cha-Cha, or Chach for short. For some reason, this random and ridiculous name I had created as a toddler stuck, and as I grew older, my brother and cousins also adopted this name. Soon, the entire family was calling him Cha-Cha. And since his passing, I've heard several accounts of fear and intimidation from his students in regards to his intellectual persona in his classroom and around the university. And while I'm sure this is true, I hope the story behind his name Cha-Cha will clarify that my grandfather was as playful, humble, and loving to his family as he was respected, and dare I say, feared by his students. As I grew up, I had the wonderful privilege of enjoying both the academic and playful sides of my grandfather. And I'll first talk about the fun. As a boy, we played many games together. The most infamous was called the fireplace game, a silly tradition he and I began when I was a toddler. The game consisted of us taking turns poking the kindling in his fireplace, watching the sparks fly, and then me laughing hysterically. We also played chess, though he never went easy on me, and we played catch in the backyard. Also, it'd be a great disservice to Gary if I didn't mention his jokes, or as we in the family call it, Beckerian humor. His jokes, in short, were both terrible and frequent. They were so bad that when I asked my brother to help me remember some for the speech, his response was, "What jokes? Those weren't jokes." The most famous and most frequent was when he'd ask, "Henry, do you want some ice cream?" As I began to respond, he'd quickly interrupt me and say, "Too bad we don't have any." So as I grew older and began to develop my own interests in economics and policy, my grandfather was always there to bounce ideas off of. In terms of policy and hot political issues, we were often in agreement. However, this was not a result of his persuasion. As one of my cousins described it, Gary never pushed his ideas on anybody. He simply asked the right questions. While I never took any of his classes here, nor experienced any fear from his military-style barrage of questioning, the lessons he taught me at the dinner table, in the living room, and late at night when I slept over at their house have radiated with me all my life. These nicknames, games, and lessons aside, what I'll miss most about my grandfather is the special feeling of warmth and joy that I always associated with his presence. Cha-Cha radiated that feeling whenever I went, wherever he went, and I saw that joyousness in the eyes of strangers, our family, and his colleagues whenever I was with him. It's that distinct joyous feeling that I will miss most whenever I'm at his house, in his office, at the Cape, and especially in his study, where I often walked in on him frequently, sinking in a nap or checking the score of the Yankees game between his writing. I love my grandfather very much. He's my biggest inspiration, and the happiest moments of my life are those I spent with him, my grandmother Gidi, and the rest of our family. He was truly an outstanding man, and his humbleness, compassion, and optimism gave me the confidence and wisdom that made me who I am today. I will love him, admire him, and miss him forever, and I will always be thankful for the time we spent together. Thank you.
I knew about Gary well before I knew Gary. In the 1960s, my father, George Stigler, was the Walgreen professor here. He himself had moved back to Chicago from Columbia, just as Gary was moving to Columbia in the fall of 1957. By the mid-1960s, my father was energetically using all the resources he could muster, including the Walgreen Fund, to bring Gary back to Chicago. Now, the two of them must have met when Gary was a graduate student here at Chicago and my father was still at Columbia. The earliest correspondence I can find is from 1956, when my father was sending Gary several letters with detailed suggestions as Gary was preparing his dissertation for publication as a book. Many of these suggestions were intended to open that path-breaking work on the economics of discrimination to a more general audience, such as suggesting that Gary move the symbolic formulas to footnotes and appendices, trying to correct the usual sins of a young researcher who is overestimating his audience. But in all other respects, Gary was already a senior scholar, and my father, even from that early day, regarded Gary as the bright future of economics. Gary, more than any other young economist at the time, saw that the powerful logic of utility maximization could address and give direction to the studies of problems in society, such as racial discrimination and even family relations. In 1970, Gary did return to Chicago, and that return to the intellectual stimulus he had known as a graduate student energized his work. Gary has mentioned two of his Chicago teachers as particularly influential. One, of course, was Milton Friedman. The other, he told me once, was a statistics professor, Jimmy Savage. Savage is less well known in economics than Milton. He came to Chicago in the late 1940s with a glowing recommendation from John von Neumann, and he soon became attached to what would become the statistics department. There, Savage embarked on an influential project to revisit the foundations of statistics from the point of view of utility theory and subjective probability. His 1954 book on this claimed to present, and I quote, an idealized theory of the behavior of a rational person with respect to decisions, rational choice. And he did say that person here could be taken to mean such units as families, corporations, or nations. Savage in no way anticipated Gary's work to come, but clearly helped stimulate it. 2 years ago, a flood in the basement of Eckerd Hall, a frequent occurrence, I have to report, President Zimmer, led to the temporary storage in my office of old department records. And I came upon the grade sheets for Savage's courses. Savage, who Milton Friedman once said was one of only two people he had known who he would classify as a genius, was indeed a savage grader. In one course, half the students received the grade D, but Gary received an A+. And when I gave Gary a copy of these records, he told me that Savage had been an inspirational teacher. Savage died at the early age of 53, and I doubt he ever had another student the equal of Gary. Gary's work in the 1960s and 70s was on human capital, human behavior, and the economics of the family, and was initially greeted with indifference or hostility in many traditional social science centers, as has been remarked. But Gary persevered with the intellectual support of colleagues and the knowledge that he was right. He seemed to have taken to heart a statement from Herbert Spencer that Frank Knight enjoyed quoting. Only through varied iteration can alien conceptions be forced on reluctant minds. Gary's experience would support that. I did not really get to know Gary until a few years after I moved to Chicago in 1979. Gary and Jim Coleman began the Rational Choice Workshop at that time. And for 30 years, Gary participated in that workshop, co-organized by Jim Coleman and then David Layton, Ed Lauman, Richard Posner, Glenn Weil, James Evans, with frequent energetic participation by George Stigler, Sherwin Rosen, Frank Easterbrook, Bill Landis, George Tolley, and many others. Now, I attended other workshops in economics on occasion, mostly as a spectator sport, and quite a sport it was. But I didn't want to go often because the disciplinary level often exceeded my knowledge. But the tone of the Rational Choice Workshop was initially set by Jim and Gary as truly interdisciplinary and mostly did not require a deep knowledge of economic or sociological theory. The workshop was dedicated to probing the limits of rational choice, of the rational choice approach of trying to explain social behavior as utility maximizing behavior. And they often invited skeptics and opponents of that approach. The discussions were invariably polite and respectful and often intellectually exhilarating. It was there that I learned the answer to the question, how, could often be yes. For example, how can you possibly explain this obviously stupid and irrational example of an action, be it a choice of marriage partner or a form of addiction or religious practice or suicide, as a rational choice? With great patience, Gary would explain politely, to the satisfaction of all, except possibly the visitor, that yes, that is a nice example. But I think you take too narrow a view of what rationality means, and let us take a closer look at your example from a broader point of view. Sometimes Gary and the rest of us learn something new. The visitors always were exposed to new insights into areas they thought they knew well, and sometimes they took away a better understanding of their own work. Of course, sometimes the visitor was simply too obtuse to seize the opportunity. Gary was a model citizen of the university. He taught eagerly and often at all levels and never failed to reply to a colleague's request for a comment on new work. He and Gidi hosted an annual party for workshop participants that kept alive the warm social cohesion that can be so easily neglected in these busy times. He encouraged younger colleagues without neglecting others. He built a community by serving as a constant participant, a prod when needed, a role model of the best that any University of Chicago faculty member could have ever hoped to be. In 1987, my father introduced Gary at the annual meeting of the American Economic Association on the occasion of Gary's presidential address. There, before an audience from all parts of economics, my father described Gary as, and I quote, the premier theorist of human capital, a leader in the revival of the economics of population, the first theorist to deal with time, and the creator of the household production function, the leader of the modern theory of crime and deterrence, and more recently of addiction, and the founder of a whole new literature on economic analysis of the family. But finally, at the end, my father spoke, already in that year of 1987, he spoke to Gary's place in history. Quote, "Gary's range and depth of creativity has rarely been matched by any other economist in the history of our discipline." Now, my father was an intimate friend of Adam Smith, David Ricardo, John Stuart Mill, Alfred Marshall, and a number of others. And this was the company that he thought Gary belonged in. This was hardly faint praise. Gary was, of course, all that and more. We miss him greatly, but we see him everywhere in his influence on economic thought and his shaping of the academic culture at Chicago and elsewhere.
First of all, on behalf of myself and the rest of my family, I want to express our deepest gratitude to all in attendance at this conference to honor Gary's work and memory. It's been a very moving experience because it gives us an opportunity to momentarily cross a bridge into his world and understand what he meant to you, to economics, to sociology, and most comforting for all of us, the profound mark he has made on intellectual history through his groundbreaking work, which you in the audience have appreciated way more than most of us could. I always joked with him, in fact, that many of the caricatures of him that you may have seen and think the Chicago School 1972 drawing reminded me that he looked a little bit like Isaac Newton. So hopefully today he's up there hobnobbing with him and perhaps having a workshop with the likes of those folks. I think one of the few things that few of us understood, but that this conference has really brought home to me and to the rest of my family, is not only how deeply respected and admired he was for his intellectual work and creativity, but also how truly loved he was for his generosity as a man, and which, at times like this, is very moving to us. This actually dovetails well into the two themes that I want to touch upon today. The first is that he cared deeply about three things: his family, his work, and the department, the University of Chicago Economics Department, that is. While most of you self-selected into economics, we were his family. Of course, that didn't mean that the rules didn't apply to us. I started a business, or another business, 3 years ago, and Gary was so generous with his time. He spent a lot of hours advising me on pricing strategy, negotiation, and just generally how to be very a good business person. And of course, I can't tell you what it was like getting advice from him. You know, sometimes I felt like I was in a workshop, or at least experienced what it was like. Of course, it was only me, and I've just got a Booth MBA. So, but aside from insights into economics and policy that I've absorbed growing up at his knee, one of the enduring lessons that Gary taught me is the importance of character. While one may make or lose a lot of money, or be buffeted by the winds of fortune, character is the one immutable feature that we always have control over. You measure a man not by his riches, of course there are exceptions to that, but by the substance of their character. This was reflected in his generosity of spirit, which I've heard echoed repeatedly these past 2 days. Case in point is, I had an intern working with me, and I'm a very small startup. He was applying to Booth, MIT, a bunch of different places, and he asked me if he could speak to Gary to get some advice about the application process, and of course, Gary did. He's at MIT now. This is also reflected in what he once told me, and I thought this was so interesting, obviously, as a great man, as you guys all attest to, was the fact that he thought being a great teacher was just as important as being a great scholar. So I only wish that he were here today to reap the reward that all of you are heaping upon him. I've never seen anyone more disciplined, somebody who I could set my watch to in terms of their work habits. When I woke up, he was usually in his study, then had a break of tea, then back at work until lunch, when he would have lunch with somebody like Murphy, another colleague, or a student, or a visitor, then back at work. He would come home and repeat the same thing at night. He truly loved sports, as Judy mentioned, but no matter, even at the ninth inning, if he had work to do, he would get up and he would leave. So, of course, he loved other things, classical music, swimming on the beach, my mom's cooking. So he was a multidimensional person. But I want to say that in some quarters, there remains a misconception as to the purpose of Gary's work, or as one could say, his whole intellectual life and that of you as his colleagues. While his work was not normative ex ante, because to do so would miss the true underpinnings driving an understanding of behavior, it was through the development of a rigorous framework applied to social problems that social welfare could be maximized. Lastly, I want to echo a remark by Pierre Andre, and end by saying that one of my biggest regrets is that there's no longer an opportunity to get Gary's opinion. While speaking with Steve Stigler yesterday, I said how sad I was to see the end of the era with Gary's passing. Or maybe it's that I'd no longer be going to any workshop parties. But that's an era that goes back to George Stigler, Milton Friedman, and economists like Viner before him. Steve corrected me. He told me it's not the case. And in fact, he was right. As someone once told me, a person who lives in memory of those they touched. As all of you who have gathered here have articulated so ably the past 2 days, Gary was a remarkable, unique, and very generous human being, both to his family, colleagues, and really almost to anybody who reached out to him. Through the impact of his wide body of work and the deep feelings he left with you and us, his family, he will continue to live on in our hearts and mind and has ensured his place in history for time to come. Again, thank you.
Today, each of us is focused on what we have lost with Gary's passing. Of course, this is toughest for Gidi and Gary's family, but we share with them an unbearable feeling of emptiness. For me, beyond the scholarly interaction that can never be replaced, there are the little things that it's difficult to believe are gone. The many lovely dinners, casual lunches that we shared together, the frequent phone calls, the meetings in the office to chat about economics, politics, family, sports, and life in general. Knowing that when things got tough or that when I needed advice, Gary would always be there for me. And I enjoyed his human side. I loved to tell Gary the latest joke and watch him laugh deeply. And by the way, that's right, he never told any jokes that were worth laughing at, so it always went one way. But he was a great teaser, and he teased me incessantly, most often making fun of the knowledge that I lacked. What, Gary would say, only half jokingly? You never heard of so-and-so, or you mean you never read that? And he'd reference some obscure article or book that maybe only Jim Heckman had read. Each of you has your own list, and when you think of them, I know that you're finding it difficult to accept that those cherished Gary memories are gone forever. But as each of us reflects on the personal aspects of our devastating loss, it is easy to forget that Gary belonged not just to us, but to the world. Yes, Gary was a great economist, but beyond that, as has already been said, Gary was the person who advanced social sciences more than any other 20th century scholar. Gary's life was spent using his genius to understand issues in every realm of society. Gary wrote the seminal paper in 7 literatures, most of which he started, and is one of the first economists who deserved to win multiple Nobel Prizes. Gary was enormously creative, but as much as that, he had intellectual courage. Gary's work was not only revolutionary, it was viewed by many to be heresy. How dare an economist talk about such important moral dilemmas as discrimination in cost-benefit terms? Who in his right mind would think of a child as a consumer durable? You guys must have inspired that. In the early years, one illustrious economist, when asked about Gary's work, replied, "Yes, I read Gary Becker. I enjoy American humor." But Gary persisted. Even though he was a very young man and was going down a path that could be disastrous for his career, he believed that what he was doing would truly help us understand the world. He had confidence in his work, and the catcalls from his detractors would not dissuade him. Gary won. He not only silenced his critics, he turned many of them into followers as they came to understand the power of his reasoning, logic, and innovation. His analysis was not only the most innovative, it was the truth. A powerful example comes to mind. One of my Stanford colleagues' wives was writing on women in the family, and my colleague suggested that she read Gary's transformational treatise on the family. She was anti-economics, anti-Chicago, and anti-Becker, but she read the book. After reading it, she was awestruck. Her reaction was that the work was brilliant, thoughtful, and dedicated. It was, she thought, the epitome of serious intellectual reasoning and reflected more than anything else a desire to truly understand this important subject. The pursuit of scientific knowledge and truth was Gary's hallmark. We all know how much Gary believed in economics. Economics was not a game to be played to satisfy intellectual curiosity or to win academic chess matches. Economics was the most powerful tool a scholar could have for understanding social phenomena. Gary once said that he used to think economics could be used to explain all human behavior, but that he changed his mind. He now thought that economics could be used to explain all behavior, human and non-human alike. Despite Gary's love of scholarship, he was a devoted family man who loved his children and grandchildren and appreciated them enormously. He often spoke about how fortunate he was to have Gidi as his wife. Gary was devoted to his academic family as well. Many of us, I among them, came to the University of Chicago to be with Gary. Gary was my idol even as I obtained my PhD among infidels at Harvard. Being able to come to Chicago as an assistant professor was a dream come true. That's because Gary made us all better. Sitting in workshops with him, watching him think, listening to his comments, and being the victim of his criticism were invaluable to our intellectual development. There is no better way to become a good economist than to be an assistant professor under or student of Gary Becker. All of us here know that Gary's powers of concentration were truly exceptional. Even at 83, Gary was always attentive to the topic being discussed. While people 40 years his junior were dozing in seminars, Gary was always alert, intense, and involved. Gary loved research and he loved the academic life. In his last days, Gidi told me how his doctors were amazed at his awareness and power to reason, even when his body was so weak. I responded that I wasn't surprised at all. Gary had so much practice staying focused in thousands of boring seminars that he could outwit anyone, no matter what his physical condition. He never gave up thinking critically. He maintained his love for doing research until his last day. We all knew that Gary would die with his boots on, and he did so galloping faster than the rest of us. A few months ago, Gary co-authored and presented a paper entitled "The Manipulation of Children's Preferences, Old Age Support, and Investment in Children's Human Capital" at a conference. It was unbelievable. Here was an octogenarian presenting a high-quality paper that reminded me of work that he was capable of doing 50 years earlier. All the conference participants remarked how impressive he was, how much energy and clarity he had. Indeed, it is true, Gary was youthful until his last day. Gary Becker was an intellectual giant. He was the kind of person who comes along only a few times each century. For this reason, we are overwhelmed by the enormity of our loss. But it's more important to remember how much we gained from having Gary with us for 8 decades. And Gary left behind for us a number of lessons. He was as smart as anyone we have ever known, and at the same time, the hardest working. We learned from Gary that intelligence is not enough. To advance science and humanity, intelligence must be coupled with unmatched effort. Complementarity is an important part of the scholar's production function. But the most important lesson we learned from Gary is to be intellectually ambitious. Gary was our profession's most creative thinker, and he never let fear of failure deter him. Gary was not only a visionary, he was a dreamer who turned dreams into reality. Gary showed us how to stretch the boundaries of our imagination and to strive for the unreachable and to always pursue the truth. Gary taught us above all to reach for the stars, both personally and professionally. And as we follow his example of combining effort with intellectual courage, we will owe much to Gary, the pioneer who remains our beacon. Now we welcome you to a reception in the Winter Garden of the Chicago Booth Graduate School of Business.
Parliam tutti, parliam tutti, parliam tutti.